Ramayana, Part 28, Shurpanakhi's Evil Advice. Shurpanakhi had witnessed Kara's death in the battle. Her heart was ready to burst. Roaring in rage, she hastened to Lanka. She entered Ravana's palace. The moment she saw Ravana, grief overwhelmed her. She remembered her brother Kara, that Lakshmana had cut off her ears and nose was stinging her pride. Weeping loudly, she approached Ravana. Grief, rage and obduracy tormented her. She said to Ravana, "Brother, know you not about the terrible pests that have descended on us? Know you not that an insignificant human being has rubbed out your 14,000 strong forces at the border? You are an emperor, and yet you sit with folded hands without doing anything to succor them? How can you tolerate your sister's ears and nose being cut off and her being disfigured? A king must shoulder the responsibility of protecting his subjects and his soldiers. But you are immersed in pleasures and have forgotten all other things. You know that borders of your empire are under attack, and yet you do nothing? Your younger brothers, Kara and Dushana, are dead. Your sister is a victim of cruel attacks, yet you do nothing? Yours is a heart of stone. A king like you is of no use to anyone." Ravana was wretched at the sight of Shurpanakhi. Her words troubled him. He could neither attack Sri Rama nor be passive. That was his plight. He said, "Shurpanakhi, who is this fellow called Rama? How could he, single-handed, destroy so many persons? Are our people cripples without arms and legs? Or are they cowards? Or else, how could so many fighting together taste defeat?" Shurpanakhi replied, "Brother, do not imagine that Sri Rama is just an ordinary fellow. He is a man of rare valor and rare prowess. I have seen any number of gods, Danavas, Gandharvas, Yakshas and Kinnaras, but never have I beheld a valiant man equal to him. He has long arms. He is very handsome. A bow is the only weapon he has. But bending that bow, he can shoot hundreds of arrows simultaneously. No matter how numerous his enemies, he can cut them all to pieces. He looks very mild. But when he fights, he is fierce like Lord Rudra. He killed Kara, Dushana and Trishira and dispatched 14,000 Rakshasas to Death's kingdom. He spared me because I am a woman. Brother, with him is his wife Sita by name. She is the daughter of Janaka, the king of Videha. She is lovely beyond words. She is the most enchanting of all the women I have seen. I went up to them because I wanted to kidnap her and present her to you. But that cruel Lakshmana disfigured me. I sought the protection of Kara and Dushana, but poor brothers, they too fell to Rama's arrows. Oh brother, I have such a formidable brother as you, and yet do I have to suffer this?" So saying, she wept profusely. And then she said, "Brother, it is not right on your part to be passive. Go at once to Janasthana and destroy Rama and Lakshmana and marry Sita. Only then will I be comforted." At these words, Ravana's desire sprouted again. "Yes," he decided, "I must kill Rama and Lakshmana and marry Sita." He went to the place where chariots were sheltered and asked his charioteer to get his chariot ready. Ravana's chariot was made of gold. It could take him wherever he willed, on the earth, on water, or in the air, no matter where. He could travel smoothly and swiftly. Ravana ascended the chariot and travelled towards the sea. As the supreme daitya endowed with 10 heads and 20 shoulders travelled in his chariot, a mountain seemed to be on the move. The chariot reached the seashore. It was a charming place. Swans and herons moved about there. Great sages were engaged in tapas. On the way, pellucid pools appeared. He also saw cities smiling with wealth and crops. Finally, Ravana reached Mareecha's ashram. Mareecha welcomed Ravana and said, "Great Ravana, how is it you are back? All are well in the capital, aren't they? No one is in trouble, I hope." Ravana replied, Mareecha, I am now in a difficult plight. You know what happened in Janasthana? My brothers, Kara and Dushana, who were there, and the thousands of Rakshasas have been slaughtered by Rama, as I told you. But that is not all. That Rama's brother Lakshmana has cut off the ears and nose of my dear sister Shurpanakhi and disfigured her. I am enraged. I wish to be avenged on him and chastise him severely for this shocking wrong. I have decided to carry away Rama's wife. You must help me. Ravana's words threw Mareecha into a panic. His mouth dried up. His limbs began to shake. With folded hands, he managed to stammer, "Great Ravana, you are in a towering fury. In your hunger for revenge, you are talking like a simpleton. You do not have the restraint you need to judge whether what you are doing is proper or improper. You do not have patience to weigh your decision and decide whether it is right or wrong, just or unjust. Therefore, however justly I may speak, my advice may not appeal to you, but I will do my duty. King Ravana, you can find many people who speak pleasantly and many people who are deceived by pleasant words, even if they do not realize whether such words will spell prosperity or ruin. People like only those who speak pleasingly. They do not relish excellent advice rendered with good intentions but not sweet to the ears. Fools do not relish good advice, just as a patient dislikes a bitter medicine, however effective it may be. King Ravana, I believe you are no fool. I hope you will tread the path of justice at least after you hear me. King of Lanka, you know not the prowess of Sri Rama. Your messenger Akampana or your sister Shurpanakhi may have been motivated by selfishness to speak lightly of Sri Rama. You have not even seen him. You have just heard what others have told you. You have not investigated their reports and ascertained how much of it is true and how much exaggeration. You should not depend solely on reports and believe anything. You have to see things yourself. You say that Sri Rama killed your younger brothers Kara and Dushana as well as Trishira and also 14,000 soldiers who were all in Janasthana. Should not this at least warn you? If the man whom you disdain as a mere human being could be so devastating, should you not ponder over his strength? O Dashashira, the ten-headed one, you know little or nothing about Sri Rama, but I know a good deal. From my own experience, I know how powerful he was and how zealous in destroying evil people, even at the age of 14. Do you know how he assailed and brought down both me and my brother Subahu when we were trying to disrupt the sacrifice of sage Vishwamitra? With a single arrow, he killed Subahu. I was driven to the seashore and hurled there. Somehow, I managed to survive and I'm here. When Sri Rama came to this forest, impelled by my former hatred, I tried to disguise myself as different illusory creatures and provoke him. But even if I behold him at a distance, I shiver. A thrill of fear passes down my spine at the sight of his bow. No, Ravana, do not attempt this mad adventure. O Dashakanta, the one possessing 10 necks, you plan to abduct Sita Devi, do you? Whoever put this idea into your head, he should be a prize fool or else your bitter enemy. He must be someone who is bitterly jealous of your happiness and prosperity, or a traitor who wants you and your people to be miserable and utterly ruined. Otherwise, he would not have instigated you to try such a suicidal plan. Do not commit this sin and do not ask me to be a partner in it. Mareecha's words inflamed the wrath of Ravana. As Mareecha had said, he was already bankrupt of sense. He had but one yearning now, and that was to capture Sita Devi somehow or the other. He said, "Mareecha, I have not come here to be preached to. I want your help, not your advice. I am determined to possess Rama's wife, and I shall do it." Mareecha, you are the master of art of disguise. Go to Panchavati as a gold deer. Hover near the hut. Sita will see the golden deer and desire it. She will urge Rama to bring her the deer. Rama will follow you, elude him and take him far from the hut. If he shoots an arrow, imitate his voice and cry aloud, "O Sita! O Lakshmana!" Lakshmana will then race to his brother's help. Sita will be alone and I will carry her off. You must obey me or else I will right now cut you to pieces. So saying, Ravana waved his sword. Mareecha realized it was no use counseling Ravana. He thought it would be better to die at the hands of Sri Rama than to be killed by Ravana. He agreed to abide by the wishes of Ravana.